listening to a Songwriter's Write Radio, only on LA Talk Radio.
Really, what happened? Just love, lyrics, and life. It's a Songwriter's Write. Yes, 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 it is. What's going on, beautiful Hollywood? I'm your boy, Scotty Grand.
My name is Leo Moctezuma.
My name is Guy B.
And you are listening to
A Songwriter's Write.
Well, it's all about love. It's all about the lyric. It's all about passion. It's all about Miss Lauren Evans,
yes,
who we have here today. What's going on, Lauren?
Man, I'm happy to be here.
I'm happy to have you here. I think we all are. Like, I'm a fan, and you know I played for Miss Jordin Sparks,
yes,
and you wrote one of her most classic songs, One Step at a Time,
which I play the piano for.
I play the piano part for that. I've been playing it for about 7-8 years now.
Wow.
So that song has become a part of me.
Yes.
You have become a part of me.
Awesome. My pleasure.
So what's been going on? What's been going on, Lauren? What's been going on in your life? Music, love? Fill us in.
Oh, my goodness. The personal stuff.
Yes.
Well, let's see. I toured for about a year and a half with DJ Armin Van Buren from Holland.
Yes.
Wow.
And had a really great time running all over the world, touring and interacting with fans. And I came home last December, and it took about 6 months really to recover from all that. I mean, I wrote here and there, but for the most part, I was just kind of recuperating.
Right.
But yeah, you know, I've been writing, actually doing a lot of contemporary Christian stuff.
Oh, I love that.
A lot of worship songs and that sort of thing, because, you know, I'm a church girl.
Oh,
what church do you go to?
Right now, I'm actually in limbo.
Oh, nice.
Is that the church?
No, might as well be.
That's a great name.
That's awesome. But yeah, so I've been doing a lot of writing in that arena. And then also, I was nominated for a Latin Grammy last year.
What?
For Song of the Year.
I should have put that on the flyer.
Can we just get a little hello?
That is a songwriter's write.
What song, what artist?
It was with Camila.
Okay.
And the song is called Decidiste Dejarme.
Decidiste Dejarme.
Yeah.
I love Camila.
You love Camila?
Love Camila.
What do you know about Camila?
Aplazame. Aplazame.
Yeah.
Oh, and he understands
like everything.
Love Camila.
I'm very impressed.
Oh, you should be.
Yeah. So I have a top secret. Well, you know, Mario and I write quite a bit together.
Love it. And Mario's the lead singer, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's so awesome.
We've been, so they've been touring this year, and then when Mario's home, we write and have some really great stuff.
I love that. Now, with this episode, what we're talking about today, ladies and gentlemen out there in video land, and I hope you guys are watching us too, because not a lot of people know that you can watch this show on latalkradio.com, not just listen to us. But this show is all about the perfect pop song, and I know that you know a lot about that because you are a fabulous pop writer.
Thank you. Not
just One Step at a Time, or not just the songs with Armin, but you've done stuff for X Factor winners, Alexandra Burke.
Yeah,
so many other people that you are really good at expressing pop standards.
Yeah,
and so I just wanted to get the conversation started about what are some of you guys' favorite pop songs of all time. Guy, Leo, Lauren, tell me.
Oh, mercy. That's such a hard question to answer.
you asked us right before we started.
Right,
the show. I mean, I'm not gonna be cliche, but actually I am. But I think if just we were talking earlier, actually 1 minute before we started. Britney Spears. I think Slave would have to be. I can probably name like 20 more.
But are you a little biased because you were in the video?
A couple things. I was in the video, but no, the song. It doesn't matter when and where. When that shit hits,
it's everything.
It's like
always.
You know.
I agree. It's so true. That beat is crazy.
It also samples "Nasty Girl," so I think it's a combination of two
of all
hot.
Of
freaking songs,
yeah. All
Slave,
okay,
and Nasty
right.
Girl.
So Slave by
Miss
Britney.
I'm a slave to the music by okay. Britney Spears.
I love it. What about you, Lauren?
Man, you know what? I'm a classic song lover, and I mean, for me, it runs the gamut of, you know, the way you're making me feel.
The way you make me feel.
You're really turning me on.
You're really turning me on.
Do knock me off of my feet now, okay. Baby.
I can't match the growl.
She's you know, yes.
So, you know, like, you know, it goes from there to like, you know, there's a hero. If you look inside your heart, you don't have to be afraid
of what?
Of what you are.
Listen to that vibrato.
You know, like.
Okay, guy.
Yeah, I think we're going to make this episode a musical. A song that is right.
Please,
the musical.
Just sing the whole time.
I love it.
Let's talk
about
it
after the show. Talk about it. Done.
Yes. Yes.
Love it. Lauren, I have to tell people this because when I first met you, I don't think I had ever met a vocalist that was so on. I mean, I had heard Whitney Houston and Mariah's on radios, but I first met you in the Bahamas. I was touring with Jordin. You were touring with Natasha Bedingfield and Aisha Humphrey.
Yes.
You guys were doing the backgrounds. Yep. We were so young.
Oh,
it's
my
so
gosh.
Crazy. And we were in the Bahamas, and I remember backstage that night, Sean Kingston, Natasha, Jordin, we all went out and hung, and I heard you sing, and then you sung a Whitney song, and I was like, oh, like seriously, guy. I was like, you hear it.
I'm doing that here. Okay. Like the voice is so you hear incredible.
It. Now, when did you start singing?
Man, I've been singing ever since I could make noise.
Yes.
Truthfully, but professionally, I've been singing since I was about 12.
Wow.
12 or 13.
How professionally? What was your first gig?
Well, my very first gig was the Prince of Egypt soundtrack.
Oh, wow. Speaking of Mariah, Whitney.
Both Whitney and Mariah.
Yeah, that was a dream project for me, you know, because I grew up listening to a lot of Whitney, a lot of Mariah, and, you know, I admired them so much, and so to have been involved in a project that they, you know, were mutually involved
in
was quite remarkable.
Oh, my goodness. Well, what was your role in that?
I was actually signed to the executive producers on that project. There were three soundtracks for that film. There was the original motion picture soundtrack, the Nashville soundtrack, and the inspirational soundtrack.
That's Nashville. Get your own soundtrack.
Yes.
We like that.
It was good. Country song?
And so, yeah, so it was a whole country album that was inspired by the Prince of Egypt. And then there was like the inspirational was more like gospel CCM album that was inspired by the Prince of Egypt.
Wow.
And at the time, I was about 14, and my stage name was Christian.
Oh, wow.
Given to me by my producers at the time. And and that was such a crazy season. And so I haven't been able to find anything on the internet, but if you, you know, look up stuff on the Prince of Egypt, I was all over the inspirational soundtrack, and also on the original motion picture soundtrack, there's a song called Humanity.
I love that.
And I start that song.
I love that. Wow. I love that.
At 14?
Yeah. 14. It was a trip.
I love it. Well, we want you guys to call in. Leo, give them that
yes,
number.
Yes, please. If you guys are watching or listening, please call in at 818-570-5085, or you can tweet us at ASWRLA.
Yes, for Miss Lauren Evans. She's up in the house, and we are talking about the perfect pop song.
Yes.
Now, speaking of the perfect pop song, like I said when we first opened the show, One Step at a Time.
Yes.
This song, when Jordin brought it to the band and we had to learn it, and I play I play that part on the piano all the time. And I catch myself from time to time as the years have gone on, I'm playing this part and I'm singing the backgrounds, and then I start really, really, really listening to the words. Mm. And even though it's a pop song, it resonates like a song that's ministering to you.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you want to show the world, but no one knows your name yet.
Yeah.
You're wondering when and where and how you're going to make it. You know you can if you get the chance, but in your face seems the door keeps slamming. Mm. Like, that's exactly right. But you know you have the talent. You know you have it. So what I want to do right now is show your talent right now on this demo.
Uh-oh.
This is the demo, actually, of One Step at a Time. This is not Jordin.
I was going to ask her to sing it, but hey.
No, we got it.
Since it is a song where it's like the musical.
Okay. I love it. It's all right. That's right. This is One Step at a Time, Miss Lauren Evans' demo version before Miss Jordin Sparks cut it.
Awesome.
One step back time.
Love that, Lauren. Love that. That's so awesome. So tell us about how this song came to be, the inspiration of One Step at a Time.
Awesome. Well, you know, it's interesting how it all came together. That was kind of in my early days as a full-time songwriter.
Yeah.
You know, I did demos for a lot of other writers and producers for years. Mm-hmm. And, you know, decided like, hey, like, I can write, in some cases, a lot better songs than this. And so I started asking some of my clients, like, hey, would you be up for collaborating?
Mm.
And one of the first people to say, like, yeah, sure, was my buddy Robbie Neville, who's an amazing vocalist and songwriter in his own right.
Absolutely.
But yeah, and so we got together, and this is actually one of the first songs we ever wrote together.
Wow.
You know, back
placed.
Then. Yeah. Well, yeah, and it was quick. It's really the only song I've ever written with the intention for a particular artist that got placed right away.
Really? Mm. So you wrote it with Jordin in mind?
Yeah.
Wow, really?
And so,
you didn't write it for Rihanna?
No.
And then it
well, Rihanna
found
wasn't
horn.
Even popping at the
time. She wasn't even.
Exactly,
she
never
right?
existed yet.
No,
right.
So the way it happened was back then, you know, we used to collect tracks from a bunch of different producers, both here and abroad. And we would have like two or three tracks that we would take with us, and we'd go down to Ocean Avenue in Santa Monica and listen to the tracks. Whatever one resonated the most with us that day, that's the one we would write to.
Mm.
And so, you know, we're sitting there in Robbie's Prius on Ocean Avenue, looking out at the ocean, and you know, we're listening to this track, and the footsteps are already there. Click, click.
Oh, love the
click,
footsteps.
Click, and you know, we're thinking, and I see this picture in my head of high heels walking down the sidewalk. And I'm like, and I don't know, I'm just like, I don't know, something with progression, with walking, with stepping, one step at a time. I just kind of blurted it out,
yes.
You know, and Robbie was like, oh, that's interesting. What does that mean to you? And I really gave it some thought, and I'm just like, well, it's about persistence. You know, it's about persistence unto success.
Absolutely.
And you know, I mean, that's my story, that's your story.
It's everyone's
and,
story.
You know, and I'm like, I wonder if this is something that Jordin would resonate with. And so, you know, we kind of went online, and I'm like, what is her story? Because I wasn't following Idol at the time.
Gotcha.
And, you know, and so, you know, I saw like, okay, well, she auditioned in Arizona in her hometown. They're like, oh, well, you know, you're not good enough to go to Hollywood. But she was persistent, and she went to the next city and auditioned again. And like, oh my gosh, you're going to Hollywood. And, you know, she stuck through that thing, and she won it.
What's up, Jordin?
Jay Spacey in
yes.
the Hazy. And yeah, so, you know, and so I'm just like, wow, you know, like, what an awesome story,
yeah.
You know, and I can, I mean, I can relate to that story, and I'm sure she'd be able to relate to that. And yeah, and the song ultimately wrote itself.
Love it.
And, you know, we got it to Jordin's management, and the rest is history.
The rest is history. And yeah. And the video turned out to be her walking down the sidewalk.
Yeah, and it's funny because I never told anybody about that.
Wow.
And so I was on tour with Natasha when I got the label FedExed me the video. And I'm watching it on the bus with Aisha.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, nobody else was there. It was just the two of us. And I'm just like, oh, my gosh.
That's exactly.
This is exactly what I saw.
Wow. You manifested
so interesting.
Yeah.
Manifested.
I love that. Oh, she yeah. did, or oh something divine brought it all together.
That's
yeah.
amazing.
And I mean, to this day, vision. it's not only one of my favorite songs, but also one of the songs that I'm probably most proud of. Only because, you know, I got so much feedback from other people about how it affected their lives.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I got an email from this lady in Knoxville, Tennessee, who was sharing with me about how, you know, she heard the song and was using it in their 10-step rehabilitation
wow.
program at this drug facility, this drug
wow.
rehab facility,
wow.
and how, you know, a lot
one
of the folks that
time.
Were there were really encouraged and inspired, and it kind of helped them to get through
wow.
their time of recovery.
I
and
love that.
Like,
doesn't that feel great when
oh,
you write
man.
Something, it goes out into the universe, and it comes back to you more than you ever
yeah.
thought it would?
I mean, for me, that's the only reason to do it.
To do it, absolutely.
You know?
I totally agree.
So good.
I totally agree. Well, let's I wanted to kind of get your take on what a pop song should be, not actually what pop music is, but what do you think, as a pop writer, a successful pop writer, what is your definition of a pop song, and how do you go about attaining one?
Okay. My definition of a pop song, I mean, you know, I think you stated it before we started, but, you know, pop just means popular.
Totally.
And, you know, for me, another thing you mentioned was manifestation, and, you know, like, I'm all about manifesting goodness and encouragement and inspiration and hope and fun. And yeah, and so, you know, for me, a pop song, the perfect pop song is one that's simple and but speaks of profound things. Mm. You know, something that, you know, children can pick up on, and it actually, you know, as they're making these declarations and affirmations through words and lyrics and song, that it actually, you know, betters their lives somehow. You know, that's the perfect pop song to me. You know, I mean, obviously,
it's transcendental. It takes you somewhere.
And
a simple way.
Yeah, in a simple way, and it makes memories.
Yes, yes.
It makes
positive
memories.
Double entendres.
There you go.
Love it.
And so
love
yeah, it. And you know, and it paints pictures. It puts it spurs the imagination and makes you feel something.
I love it. Well, what about you, Guy? What is a pop song to you? And actually, did you say your favorite pop song yet?
No.
Not yet.
Hit it.
Go for it.
Then I'm after you.
There's so many different ones at different times, but the one that I remember just affecting me so much was when it first came out, and just was so deeply affecting me was "I Have Nothing." Mm. When that came out,
mm-hmm.
I was like, dun, 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 "What is happening in life?" I just
yes.
remember listening to that over and over. So I mean, of course, I fall in love with songs all the time, but that one for some reason is.
And what is a pop
yeah.
song to you?
It's a piece of work that takes you on an emotional journey.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes you feel the emotion of the lyric and the melody, because mm-hmm. a lot of people aren't able to actualize that. A lot mm-hmm. of people aren't able to even express it, whether it's in language or whether it's in words. And here are these songs that are actually a vehicle for people to express themselves, which is the healing part. And so that's what a pop song is.
Totally. I think a pop song to me is something that takes the gravity out of life.
Yeah.
It can be a mm-hmm. heavy subject, but it lifts you
hmm.
in a simple, fun, light way. You mm-hmm. know, it's like all the problems that I had, you could be, your lyrics could be juxtapositioned to different, you know, pain and love in the same song,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
but it still finds a way to levitate you. To heal you, you know,
yeah.
in a simple, fun way. Like you let your hair down, I don't have any hair, but I let it down. And then, you know, I feel like I'm flying. I feel like I'm free.
I remember Brian McKnight's "One Last Cry."
Oh,
did that.
Oh my goodness!
Lord.
Oh my goodness!
Yes.
I remember it made me so sad, but it healed. It was uplifting
yes.
in
yeah.
a sad way somehow. But
yeah.
that's
oh
the magic.
Goodness.
That's
yeah.
the magic.
I have this song. Shadadoop.
Yes.
Shadadoop da doop da dong.
Yes.
Shadadoop dong. We love as one, babe. What? That song, her swinging on that doggone tire,
yeah.
it arrested my mind.
Yeah.
I was like, swing again. One more, Mariah. One more swing.
But really, every one of those songs
Everyone.
That
yeah.
she came out with in the first
pop
like,
perfection.
Five records.
I'd say
oh,
that,
yeah.
was, that was pop perfection. Visions,
Dreams
emotions.
Love.
Excuse that
me.
One.
Take me up, take me down, take me anywhere you want to, baby, now.
Yeah.
Yeah, like.
A songwriter's right. Yeah,
songwriter's right
all
day. That's what we do. Oh, you better stay stuck.
But interesting
there we go.
That. But interesting that a lot of our favorite songs are from the 90s
totally.
Or from
absolutely.
Way back
totally.
When
absolutely.
The songs were cultivated and really like the lyrics, the
totally.
Melody, the emotion. And
the
it
hooks,
does seem like
hooks,
pop
the
songs
hooks.
These
I wanted,
days
I wanted
are
to,
a little void of that.
I wanted to kind of touch on that because I think it's kind of moving away from that hookiness. The melodies are getting lost and no melodies building, no stories being told.
I mean, I think, you know, I think there are exceptions. Though.
Totally.
You know,
totally.
Like Sia.
Yes.
You know, I want to swing from the chandelier.
Like,
you know, like,
that's the story
yeah,
of a melody.
Yeah, it's a story. You know, and there's a reason why Adele
Brilliant.
Works.
Totally.
Mm-hmm.
Totally.
You know what I mean? I mean, her lyrics are well crafted. Her
yes.
melodies are well crafted.
Right.
I wanted to talk about that. I have the elements of a great pop song here.
Mm-hmm.
One, song structure.
Mm-hmm.
Verse, pre, chorus, bridge. We mostly know about that.
Mm-hmm.
Melody. We know that, you know, most people, I've heard somebody say the melody is like the girl who walks in the club with the red dress. She gets
yeah.
your attention.
Mm-hmm.
But the lyrics is when she talks
mm-hmm.
to you.
Mm-hmm.
And you
mm-hmm.
see if she has substance or
mm-hmm.
not. You know, but that melody, mm-hmm. sticks in your brain.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Just like that red dress.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, but then she talks and you're like, ooh, I got to turn the station.
Yeah.
You know, or not.
Or
you know?
Not. Oh, yeah. Or
you
want to listen.
Or you
want to
listen. You got
yeah.
the whole package. You know? And also the range of a song, which I never really kind of realize that a range of a song really kind of depicts on how many people connect to it.
Yeah.
Because you're singing along, and all of a sudden, you in the rafters.
Yeah.
The people singing with you are like, you yeah. that. Go ahead.
Can't go there.
We gonna come back on the verse.
Yeah.
You know. So what are some elements, or Leo? I know you're just starting out and getting into your craft as a songwriter. What are some things that you found out writing that have helped you get to the status of somebody remembering your song quickly?
Absolutely. I think just the honesty.
Mm-hmm.
The honesty and the reality, the real life. Like, yeah. I feel like any song that I've written in the past couple years, and, you know, I'm new at this, and I fell in love with this, and things that I don't think people are going to relate to, but it's just like, because I feel like it's my experience that it was only me that went through this experience, but then someone hears it and it's like, oh my God, I mm-hmm. love that song because I went through the same thing. You know what I mean? So it's that, it's just the honesty and of course, I mean, the hook for me, it just needs to
totally
like keep ringing, and if it keeps ringing in your head, that's it's a good pop song.
I love that. This is actually from Mr. Simon Cowell himself. Mm-hmm. He had a list of what you should put into a song to make it a hip hop song, and the thing he says is, say something new. Fame, stage, and screen lyricists, they often claim to the success of their songs is that they say something new and fresh about the human condition that everyone lives, mm-hmm. which is so true.
Yeah.
It's like, Adele, never mind, I'll find someone like you. What?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That vulnerability in that lyric is like, I came to your door to tell you I still love you. Oh, wait, you got somebody?
Never mind.
But then she says, I'ma find someone
like you.
What? Who admits that?
Mm-hmm.
You know, nobody, but we all do in our personal time, which is why we're going to go and listen to it 30,000 times on Spotify alone and cry because we relate.
I have a songwriting question for you.
Okay.
And this is actually something that continues to come up. Actually came up today with a songwriter friend of mine because... Uh-huh. Like, how long does it take you to create to write a song?
Well, that depends on the song and what you're trying to say. You know, I mean, people like Diane Warren, you know, they'll spend a week crafting a song.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've heard, you know, Max Martin's camp, sometimes they spend a month crafting a song.
And then there's like Taylor Parks
and Shiloh sometimes
genius
that just,
and it just comes
minutes,
out
yeah.
and there is no revisions.
Sometimes a great song comes out in 20 minutes.
Yeah,
I'm about to say, I'm sure you've had that experience, right,
Larmin,
where it just comes.
Yeah,
there is no fighting.
It writes itself.
It does.
You just
it wants
open
to be written
and write it down, and it's there.
Yeah,
right.
I mean, I don't think there are any rules to you know how long or how short is there to write a song. It's
totally.
Just like,
yeah,
that's the
but
beauty
I think,
of it.
I think a lot like I know old school executives are like, it takes a month and you have to do it. And you know, because I own a recording studio where the biggest songwriters on a daily basis are in and out of there, I kind of I get to experience the process and really just see exactly what happens, and then I see whether it ends up on the radio or gets placed or not.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you know, I don't see songs taking that long usually to write,
mm-hmm.
but
yeah.
I know that there's some people that are like, oh, if it was written really quickly, then it's not as, you know, it's not as deep or whatever. But
it's not true. Totally not true. I don't think you know.
That was
what's so funny though, that sometimes labor of loves turn out to be the love.
Yeah.
Do you know Whitney Houston's "I Will Always Love You"? That's the 17th mix
version of it.
No, it's the first mix that they chose to go with. Hmm. They mixed it 17 times.
Oh, well, now we're talking about mixing.
Or just anything. The process of getting something right. That's it's all led by inspiration. Mm. You can't tell that song when it's done. The song tells you when it's done.
Yeah.
You know, you can't tell that album when it's done. The album is going to talk to you when it's done.
And you can't force it.
Absolutely. Or people will notice.
Yeah.
You know?
Or else it'll feel forced.
Totally. Mm. I love it. So let's keep going. Tell us some more about this new venture that you have with this DJ Armin Van Buren.
Well,
who's amazing, by the way.
Oh, Armin's amazing.
Yeah, he's
Armin
amazing.
Actually just released his next record last week, which is great. It's called Embrace.
I love it. More songs for my spin class.
Unfortunately, I'm not on that one, but I'm sure it's amazing.
I love
Armin
it.
Armin's officially...
Nice.
I mean, he's been named the number one DJ in the world for a long time.
For a long time. Long time. So without further ado, intro this one, Alone.
All right. So this song I wrote with... my friends D Mile and Victoria Horn.
Yeah, Victoria.
And that's my girl.
Yeah.
And and it was birthed out of a conversation, and is another one that I'm also really proud of. And
I'm proud of you for this one. These lyrics are amazing.
Thank you.
Seriously, let's hit it.
Alone.
Everyone is part.
goodness. Crazy. Yes, Lauren. That was awesome. And you are in that video.
Yeah.
Front and center, ladies and gentlemen. She is in this video front and center, working it out in the middle of a street in London Town. Where are you guys at?
We're in downtown LA.
Downtown LA.
8th and Broadway.
I thought that video concept was really fresh.
Thank you.
Are we alone? Everybody's connected, but nobody's connected.
Yeah.
Like, where's the feeling? Like, I'm missing it. Yeah. Are we alone? But we're not alone. That's so true. Yeah. Did you get that from Facebook?
No, it just came into my brain.
I'll be like, no. I know I got 5,000 followers, but why I get 2 likes? Am I not connected? Am I not connected?
Can't nobody see I'm trying to share this stuff with you?
Tell us how this one came about.
There was a season when me and D-Mile and Lady V were getting together periodically to just write, you know. Because sometimes you write with a particular project in mind, but most of the time,
when you
find your tribe that you just
stick
click
with,
you know, you just you write sometimes to write,
set up camp, and
great songs come out of that. And so, we were writing and we were scheduled to write that day. We got in and Victoria was so flustered, you know, and I'm just like, what's going on, girl? Talk to me. And she was just distraught. She was talking about how on her way in. She's at a busy intersection in Hollywood, and this elderly man. So basically, the video is the story behind the song.
Oh.
And so there's an elderly gentleman who was walking across the street, and he fell, and he collapsed in the middle of the street. And though a bunch of people saw it, nobody came to his aid. Nobody asked him if he was okay. Nobody bothered to.
Wow.
Just kept walking by.
Just walking by, like.
And she was so like. Freaked out, you know. She actually parked her car and got out, and you know, helped the guy up, and you know, helped him back across the street, and he was fine. He just lost his balance, but you know, like it just got her thinking about like how cruel is humanity
becoming
at this point
totally.
That we are so busy, in our own bubble, in our own existence, that we don't even acknowledge our fellow man.
Yeah,
especially when they fall.
And it's probably like an LA thing or a big city thing, because I'm sure that there's towns or cities or places where it's a different mentality. But
I don't know. I went home to New Orleans and everybody was like, Facebook. Oh hey. Like, is this the South? where the hospitality went? Because y'all don't give a fuck about nothing that's happening with me.
Well, it's like when Michelle fell and Beyonce and Kelly kept walking.
Oh, Lord.
I mean, people are not even present on stage.
I mean, you better get up, girl. I don't know. Girl, you better get up. We performing, girl.
Yo.
The show must go on.
Get up on you 5, 6, 7, 8.
6, 7. Don't miss the one, girl, because
That
is so
sorry,
funny.
I had to lighten it up.
I love it.
Deeper.
No,
like,
that's so true, though.
Yeah.
Are we alone?
Yeah, when she got to the studio, she told us a story. And, it's that conversation that sparked this song. And,
And it's a hit.
Thank you.
I love. I felt so much pride watching the video because I keep it with you on Facebook, and I'm like, oh, she has a single with Armin. Oh, that's amazing. Because I do a lot of work with DJs overseas, and so I watched the video and I was like, yes, and she's in the videos. I'm talking about.
Yeah.
They literally. I'll tell you what happened to me. I had a hit with a DJ, and they got some random black guy with a gap in his mouth, pantomiming my lyrics. Pantomiming my voice, and I'm like, yeah, that's me. Nah.
Oh, no.
That sounds like the 90s.
I was happy that you were in there and telling the story and living your truth. It was so awesome.
Yeah, thank you.
Awesome. Well, let's keep this going, guys. Yeah. So good.
I have a question about, back, of course, songwriting. So songwriters, right? Mm-hmm. When it comes to writing, writing for yourself,
yes.
Or it can be the same for different artists too. Do you like writing to a track or? Do you, like for me, I like to come up with the melody and bring it to a producer because then I feel like the song is mine. Mm. So sometimes when I hear it, when I'm writing to a track, which I don't do often, I feel like the melody's in there already, so that's what you end up writing to.
Yeah.
So do you feel, is there a disconnect or how do you feel about that?
Man, goodness. Well, it's two things for me. Like when you mentioned writing for myself, I actually had to learn how to write for myself because I've been in the habit of writing for other people for such a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And I put a little bit of my voice in everything that I write anyway. And so I had to learn how to write for me. When I think about it too much, I get writer's block, which is ridiculous. And I never get writer's block.
Wow.
But when I think, it's got to be really great. And, when I put all the pressure on myself.
No, absolutely.
You put more pressure on yourself, it's like being constipated.
As you should.
It don't want to come out. So,
I just got that.
She snuck that in.
My lyrics are constipated.
It won't come out. Help. But, I prefer, I mean, I do write to track, and I'm with you. You know, like, oftentimes the track dictates what the melody's going to be. Certainly. And even the, where the lyrics are going to fall rhythmically, you know. And so I actually prefer to start from the ground up. I don't play anything. I'm not an instrumentalist. That's not my ministry. But I know a lot of really great guitar players and keyboard players. And
so
sometimes I'll just call someone over and like, hey, you know, I have this song idea or I have this melody. You know, can you help me suss through what, you know, what the bed of it should be?
I think that's how almost all my songs that you guys have heard is like.
Until you start working with me, baby, then we bringing out that keyboard, the flute, the piccolo, the harmonica.
No, you know, that's what I want to do. Yeah, because I have all these like little voice notes and things that I want to.
Absolutely.
But I just like, I don't really know all the time where the music is going to go.
Totally, totally.
But my
you are kind of at the mercy of that track.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But.
A little bit. Gotcha, gotcha. Yeah, I love it. Well, let's get on. Lauren, a part of this show, show's segment is called The New New, and that's the segment that we're going to do right now. And this is my guy, my boy, my Mr. Cyrese K. He's an amazing guy from London town.
Cyrese
is amazing, and his influences are the Beatles, David Bowie, Aerosmith, a lot of rockers. And this guy is a phenomenal guitarist, phenomenal lyricist, and it's different than the music that we've normally played, which is I'm in love with that.
I'm
all about it. So this is his single, Love Times Three. And I'm on the background. Ooh. Ooh. Ooh.
Not pretty enough to be an angel. Way too pretty to be a bum.
Talking about truth and authenticity, you know that's his story.
Oh, you know that's his story. Absolutely. They say that my brain's on its last legs from all of the drugs that I've done.
Dope.
It's been such a long time since I've loudly said that I need love. Mm. I need love. Love. I need love, love, love.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's honest.
You know? And Cyrus is going to call in a little bit and he's going to talk with us.
Awesome.
This guy has such an amazing story. He was signed as a hit rock band in London, had a whole bout with drugs. And then came to America, found a different way, decided to get away from London and start really, he has Bowie tattooed on his arm because that's one of his biggest inspirations.
Yeah. Mm.
So he just put out this album and it's all on iTunes and it's his first project I think he's put out since he's been sober.
Wow.
And he's been sober I think in 10 years?
Wow.
Now he just had his 10 year sobriety
God
party.
Bless him.
That's awesome.
So awesome. What did you guys get from that song?
What we just talked about.
Right. That is that actually him, right?
And then that hook is I need love, love, love. You know what I mean? Like times three.
I love it. I'm waiting for Cy to call. I don't know. Maybe he got disconnected. But let's keep this going. We're going to take a little break, you guys, and we're going to be right back.
Just love lyrics and life. It's a songwriter's ride.
You're listening to a songwriter's ride.
Prepárate. vi, y tú a mí. No puedes negar, hay algo especial.
Se acabó.
Me acerco a ti, siento el calor. Déjate llevar, es tiempo de bailar.
There's an inner sea of stars, a flicker with a lonely heart. Will you see me in the dark? Maybe tonight. Feels like you're in outer space. How can I communicate? Will you come around my
amazing. That was two of our co-host songs, Chakaboom by this man right here. And that was Electric Hearts by Miss Lauren Evans. And your group.
Yeah, so the group's called Electric Hearts. A couple friends of mine got together and decided we wanted to start writing. And next thing you know, this whole thing emerged. And so we have this group now. We just released our first single. That was it, Maybe Tonight. And it was the first project from my label.
What? Love you have your own label?
Really? Your
now,
own
yeah.
label?
Nice. Yeah.
So wow. How did that
come
about?
Are you looking for new artists?
Just put it together. You know, I mean, it's a little indie label.
That's
and,
awesome.
You know,
that's what I'm talking girl, yes. I'm talking about go after it and get it.
Yeah.
Oh, you want one? Okay,
Google check. Entrepreneurship.
Oh, we got a call.
Yes.
Let's take this call. What's going on? Did you listen to a Songwriter's Right? Who's calling and who's your question for?
This is Cyrus
K. Ah, Cyrus! There he is.
Love times three, baby.
I your show with my silly London accent.
It's fantastic.
How are you, Cy?
I'm doing all right. I'm alive and I'm well. How are you guys?
Nice.
We're awesome, man. You called a little bit late, but we still want to get a little insight into this song that I was so happy to sing backgrounds on for you, Love Times Three. Please give the people a little bit of behind the scenes of how this song came about and what it was inspired from.
That song in particular, that was, as you probably guessed, it was kind of a mini biography of basically the one big need that you neglect as well. I neglected myself of my entire life, trying to fill myself up with, anything external I could.
Besides love.
I'm not going to go through the list of them. I'm sure you will know some of the things are. And the realization that all I need is love. And I just thought, why not say it?
Yeah.
Wow.
Three times.
I love that, man. That's awesome. So with this project, man, what's been the feedback that you've been getting back? Are you happy with the project? That I know this has been a project that you've released after not releasing music for a while, right?
Well, yeah, I spent the last few years writing for other people. I was scared. You know, I've been listening to the show and he said I've been sober 8 years, not 10 yet.
But, sorry, I was trying to give you two more.
Sort of, do my own project, and I'm going to keep adding to it. But so far, I've just managed to get some of the songs placed in a few movies and TV shows, getting exposure.
Congrats!
I'm a publisher
That's awesome.
With it, so it's more than I hoped for. I didn't really have any expectations. I did it for the therapy, you know. I did it for me.
That's good.
Absolutely. Like we were just saying, Lauren, like there's no other reason to do it before that gratification that you get from your gift.
Absolutely.
That's awesome, man. Well, thank you for being our Nunu this week, Cy.
Woohoo!
Amazing.
Yeah,
amazing.
I am very, very thankful. I'm the Nunu. I appreciate it.
We wish you much more success with your project.
Thank you. Same to you, Lauren.
Thank you.
Appreciate
it. For sure.
Peace
out, Cy.
See you later,
Cy. See ya.
Awesome.
See you later. Thanks, guys.
Love that.
Cheers.
Love that.
Is it time for?
It is time for. Yes, it is. Obsessed. This is the part of our segment. I keep saying our segment. This is the segment in our show. That's what I be trying to say.
This is a big old long segment.
This is the segment of the segment of the segments that we have a segment for. You know, but this is the part of our show where we go around the table and we say what we are obsessed with this week. So think about it. You start, Leo. Okay.
Really?
You go. Go.
All right. So really? Yes. We have a time here?
Yep.
So my obsession this week is a song called Ghostown by Adam Lambert.
Absolutely.
And part of my obsession, part of the reason why I'm obsessed with it, I've actually loved it for, you know, since it came out and played in my spin classes and stuff, but like I went to his
Halloween party,
and he performed it, and it's just unbelievable how incredibly talented this. But the voice is so striking, and so like since that night that he performed it live, I've just been like, and then there's so many incredible remixes to that song.
It's a really cool song.
It's such a great song. And when you listen to the lyrics and you listen to just the depth of what it's saying, it's just and then just live performances. Because, you know, to be able to sing something live better than on record.
And that vocal is on fleek
all the time.
Shout out to
I would say that is a okay, I'm says, yeah. I love it. Go ahead, Leo. We're gonna save Laura.
So I'm like the obsessed promoter here. Every time I
having flyers.
I'm trying to get sponsored here. We're trying to get sponsored.
Hey.
My obsession this week actually is it was just open. It's the grand opening of a fitness studio called Booty Works. Booty Works. It's on Ventura Boulevard. It's on 12307 Ventura Boulevard, like kind of Whitsett-y, between Laurel and Whitsett. And the website is www.bootyworksfit.com. And right now they're offering free classes until the 8th.
Hop.
Yeah.
Yes, one
of the classes is Fit Hop. See the hat that I'm wearing, Fit Hop? Mm-hmm. One of my good friends and one of my best friends, Chris Dupre and Keith.
Chris?
I have a fitness program called Fit Hop. It's like a fitness hip hop. And I'll be actually assisting them. And when they can't do it, I'll be teaching a class.
Nice.
So you guys got to check it out. But they have some amazing classes at Booty Works. Hmm. I mean.
Are you like guaranteed a booty? Because I have none.
Yo, if you're there consistently. I just took a class today called Pound. And it's with drumsticks.
Oh, wow.
It's like really, really fun, cool classes that are not normal that you won't find at the gym. So
I love it.
That's my obsession. I've been going. I came there right from
here. I'm
going
to go tomorrow to the hip.
Sweating.
To the Fit Hop.
Check it out. Yes.
So that song?
Awesome.
Okay, I think that you're obsessed with that. That's awesome. I need to come with you and get a booty.
I'm trying to get obsessed with fitness. I need to get my...
Miss Lauren Evans, what are you obsessed with this week?
Speaking of booties... This week, I've been obsessed with the sea salt caramel gelato at Whole Foods.
She said, speaking of booties, that will give you one, butter.
That will grow your booty real quick.
Gelato.
It's so delicious.
Now, is that different than ice cream?
It's very different.
How so? Because Italians made it?
Yes. That's one reason.
All right.
And this is actually imported from Italy. Mm. But no, it's like, you know, it's pure ingredients. It's simple ingredients. And you can look on the cart and it's like, oh, okay, well, it's milk and... you know, caramel, you know, sugar, and, you know, and yeah, and it's from Whole Foods, so it can't be all
it
that
can't
bad.
It can't be that bad, but it can't be that expensive.
Yes, it can. Yeah, it can. Whole paycheck.
Whole paycheck.
Before you get to your obsession, since we're talking about fitness, and I actually brought some treats for us today.
Oh, wow.
Since Halloween just passed,
and a lemonade bag.
Next to Booty Works, there's a lemonade store, so I bought some cupcakes for us.
Oh, please add to my fad.
Yes.
Who knows? Maybe you have one of these and be obsessed with this.
Okay, got you.
But so we'll have this.
I love that.
So it'll give us an excuse to go to Booty Works.
Why not?
Exactly.
Now we have a reason to work it off. So I would say, Lauren, that's on.
You are obsessed with that. What are you obsessed with? What are you obsessed with?
I am obsessed with this app. One of my best friends, actually my best friend, Michael Cole, he showed me this app called Rhymer's Block.
What?
And it's for songwriters.
Oh, very cool.
And it's actually really sick. It's just an app on your phone. It's free. Uh-huh. And you type in, and as you're typing, it starts giving you all of these rhyming words as you're typing, as well as you can look up a dictionary. It has games on it and stuff. It's actually really interactive.
Hmm.
And I'm a little bit obsessed with it. I haven't gotten too much into it, but from what I have, obsessed.
Obsessed.
Absolutely. Oh, Leo, which one? Can I get that red velvet, though?
You can get that red velvet. Oh, we can cut them and everybody can taste one.
Fuck a cut.
Red velvet.
I love that. So it's time for Love That Lyric, guys. And this week... This week's is actually your song, Lauren.
Mine?
Yes, is, because like I said, One Step at a Time is now a part of me. Oh, wow. I can play that riff in my sleep. I can, you know, sing the harmonies. I know all the bridge harmonies. Time, ooh, all of it.
Okay. Yes. Okay. And
the arrangements, the background arrangements are crazy.
While y'all dig into that, I'm going to just recite these lyrics. One Step at a Time, the artist that cut it and was written for, it's Jordin Sparks. What up,
yes.
Jay?
Yes.
Hurry up and wait. So close, but so far away. Everything you've always dreamed of, close enough for you to taste, but you just can't touch. You want to show the world, but no one knows your name yet. Wonder when and where and how you're going to make it. You know you can if you get the chance. In your face as the door keeps slamming. Now you're feeling more and more frustrated and you're getting all kind of impatient, waiting. We live and we learn to take one step at a time. There's no need to rush. It's like learning to fly or falling in love. It's going to happen when it's supposed to happen. And we find the reasons why, one step at a time. Oh my God, I love that. That's the part that I emphasized. It's the one that got me. Mm. It's gonna happen when it's supposed to happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So many times I was playing that like, oh, I can't wait to be singing front stage and not playing keyboards, but it's gonna happen when it's supposed to happen. Mm.
See, and I like the part that comes after that that says, and you'll find the reasons why one step at a time.
Exactly.
You know, it's kind of like, you know, when you find yourself in the place that you've been dreaming about, when you find yourself in the place of your dreams, sometimes you forget to look back and recognize what was being built in you on the way.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Absolutely.
Because, I mean, you know, oftentimes things don't happen until we're ready for them.
Right. And oftentimes,
we might think we're ready.
Absolutely.
The things that are the worst and that are the most challenging are just preparing you for
the best. Yeah. To know how to deal with it.
Yeah. Absolutely, because the struggle
absolutely.
Is real.
The struggle is real.
The pain is real.
Well, let's keep it going. I have one more
game for y'all. And we're going to end it out like this. You know I love a good game. And this game involves bubbles.
Yes.
So the thing is, y'all have to pop a bubble. Mm. Actually, two bubbles. And then answer the question. Okay? And when you get the question right, you get a candy.
So okay, so the bubbles are blown. When are you asking the question?
Yeah, I'm going to ask the questions, then blow the bubbles.
Okay.
Okay? Ready?
This is fantastic.
This is everything.
Don't get no bubbles on the
on the cake. Just because there's cakes, let's make it one bubble.
We gonna
you
got to
pop one bubble and then answer the question. Okay?
Okay.
Here we go. Question one. What legendary U.S. festival that hosted over 350,000 fans took place in 1969.
Woodstock.
Yeah.
Woodstock, baby.
That's for you.
Oh, thank you. Woodstock.
Question
You're
gonna
need
two.
To blow those a little bit further.
Okay, it's the first to three.
Because that's not going to be very like.
He's like, let me get up. Okay, I got the bubbles for you. In what city was the famous rapper Notorious B.I.G. shot and killed in a drive-by shooting?
Let it come on. We gotta blow him by. Blow him by.
No, good. Pop it for him. Get it.
You,
boom.
There you go.
Los Angeles.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
Here we go. I get the bubble, but I don't get the candy.
Okay. In 2001, a plane crash killing this R&B starlet returning from a video shoot in the Bahamas. I popped it for you. Go.
I did. Aaliyah.
Yes. Oh, I like this one. Y'all all getting one. I like it.
Yes. Go team.
Okay, here we go. In the late 1990s, a new wave of bubblegum pop artists/bands became popular. Who were three of these artists' bands in the 1990s? Bubblegum pop.
Pop like, that. He's come like, on, give pop me it over here.
Get it. Oh.
Oh.
Hit it.
Oh, I got that.
Hit it.
NSYNC. Backstreet Boys. 90 Degrees.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, missed that one.
Cool. So I could do without the candy.
Basically.
All right, we got, guy has two, so we're going. Here we go. At the age,
you're
at
just
what
giving
age?
It to him, though.
At what age did popular musicians Janis Joplin and Jimi Hendrix both die from drug overdoses? At what age?
Ooh.
Ooh, I like my question.
Google it.
Oh, let me.
Blow the bubbles.
Oh, why they don't go far, though?
Was it 27?
Yes. Nice. Oh, I'm just bouncing candy everywhere.
Actually, did I read that somewhere where a lot of
Yeah, it's a club.
Tell the 27 Club. Jamie, yep, yep.
God bless them.
The Amy Winehouse. So crazy.
Amy Winehouse. Totally, totally. Wow. Okay, here we go.
The devil is a liar.
Shoals.
Come on. What was Elvis Presley's first number one hit record?
Ooh.
I can blow for you.
Okay, you blow for me. You, yeah, blow him, Leo.
Blow for you. Blow for you. That's
good.
Heartbreak Hotel.
I swear really? I thought it was that.
I just popped the bubble. I don't know the answer.
No.
Act like you don't know it.
Was it Heartbreak Hotel?
Yes, it's Heartbreak Hotel. There you go.
Wait, why you gotta sneak in the answer?
I know, but damn sure I don't know what it is. So I'm like, I know you know Whitney.
But though. I love you did the Whitney version.
So, Lauren, thank you so much for being on the show with us today.
Thank you for having me.
For sure,
for
sure. We can't wait to hear more about what you're doing and follow your new successes, stuff that you have going on in your solo, everything.
And do you have anything that's out that is you as a solo artist?
Not officially yet, but mm-hmm. that's in the works for 2016.
Yes, that love it. Should cool.
absolutely where can we follow you? Where can we find you?
Twitter and Instagram at The Real L Evans.
Yes.
Facebook, official. Lauren.Evans.
Love it. And I'll put all these on Twitter.
Please do.
Or you can just go to my website, I guess they don't do that anymore. LaurenEvans.com. And that'll connect you.
That means World Wide Web.
I guess they don't do that anymore.
At all.
It's like HTTP.
Okay, no, that's done. It's understood now. So, you guys, this is another great episode of A Songwriter's Right. Next week, we have the amazing Mr. Alan Rich, who wrote Run to You by Whitney Houston.
Brilliant.
And we're talking about the greatest male voices of all time. So let's take the show out with Mr. Leo Chakaboom.
Chakaboom! Bang, 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 dance! Chakaboom! Bang, 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 dance! Chakaboom! Bailas así, no puedo competir. Ese movimiento me va a derretir. Me tienes mal, no puedo parar. Ahora me toca a mí. Chakaboom por fin. Tu bang 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 bang. If you do bang bang do do bang 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 bang